Check 1, 2. Good morning. Hey, is this on? Hello? Can you hear? Oh, there we go. Hey. Good morning, Lakeview Church. If you guys would stand up with us, we're going to get started here in worship this morning.
You will never run away. You're forever mine. You will never run away. You're by my side. Hey! Love deeper than the seas, countless is all infinity. Love like a shooting star, tearing apart the dark, shining for all eternity. Shining for all eternity, oh yeah. You will never run away, you will never mind. You will never run away, you're by my side. You will never run away. You'll forever shine. You will never run away. You'll find my side. Hey!
Love stronger than the grave. Rub, roll the stone away. Rising within this majesty. Love takes us by the hand. Love is the wildest dance. You are the joy inviting me.
You are the joy inviting me. Oh yeah. You will never run away. You're forever mine. You will never run away. You're by my side. You will never run away. You'll forever shine. You will never run away. You're by my side. Hey!
Open wide, hands lifted high, over the clouds up into the blue skies. Hearts open wide, hands lifted high, over the clouds up into the blue sky.
Hey!
Hearts open wide, hands lifted high, over the clouds up into the blue sky. Hearts open wide, hands lifted high, over the clouds up into the blue sky.
Come on! You will never run away. You're forever mine. You will never run away. You're by my side.
Hey!
You will never run away. You'll forever shine. You will never run away. You're by my side. Hey!
My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours. You are mine. You are mine. You call me out. Upon the waters, the great unknown. If he may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep. My faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves
oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. You are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. And fear surrounds me. You never fail, and you won't stop now.
Come on.
And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are. You are mine. When oceans rise,
come on.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you will call me. Take me deeper than my feet would ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, whatever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. For you are mine when oceans rise. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are mine. You are mine when oceans rise.
Thank you.
this morning, Lord.
Turned into wine and opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. There's none like you. And into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. And our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? What can stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, yeah. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who can ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? Then what can stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome to Lakeview Church. Anybody else excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Absolutely. Those of you joining us online, I want to say a special thanks and welcome to you. Just know this is the easiest moment in your life to invite a friend to church. You can hit that share button and immediately invite all of your friends to join us as we continue in worship together. My name is Tim. I'm the lead pastor here. So excited to be here with you this morning. Want to say thank you for continuing to give to the mission and vision of Lakeview Church. We have multiple ways for you to give. We have giving boxes on the walls in the back. If you're watching online, you can give online. You'll see a link in the description above. Also excited, we had a great membership class last week. You'll be hearing more about some of those new members here in the coming weeks. And I want you to go ahead and mark your calendars for Sunday, November 8th. We've had quite a few say, the Lord has rocked my life and I'm ready to be baptized. So we're going to have a celebration of baptism on November 8th. We'll probably do it right out here on our beautiful campus. So if you're interested in getting baptized, we'll open up signups for baptism this afternoon. We'll have a baptism class the week before and tell you what we believe the Bible teaches about baptism. All right, I hope you are ready because we're about to kick it into another gear. We're going to pick up the pace over the next few weeks. We are traveling verse by verse through the book of Acts, and we're not slowing down. So today we're going to cover almost 40 verses, which is a lot of scripture. Last week we only covered 12. It was the first 12 of Acts 13. We started this missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas and John Mark. They were on the island of Cyprus last week. It was there, you remember the story, they encountered Sergius Paulus, who was an intellectual man, and also the magician Bar-Jesus, which means son of the Savior, but as we know from Paul's language, he called him son of Satan and put that magician in his place. And we learned last week that when we proclaim the gospel, some people will be open to God's word. Sergius Paulus received the word and actually became a believer. Some people will oppose God's word and some will embrace it. We're going to see that pattern continue today. So if you have your Bibles, turn them with me to Acts chapter 13. We're going to be in verses 13 all the way to 52. Acts 13, starting in 13, our author Luke says this. Now, Paul and his companions set sail from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia. And John Mark, left them and returned to Jerusalem. Now, let me push pause here and say this. We don't know exactly why John Mark left. Can we speculate? Sure. Can we make some guesses? Yes. Was he scared of the treacherous journey ahead? Possibly. Was he simply homesick? Maybe. Was he protesting Paul's leadership? Did he contract an illness? We don't know. We can guess, sure. Luke just tells us that John Mark, who later authored the Gospel of Mark, left. He did not continue on in the missionary journey. I don't want us to read too much into the text here, but I think it's important to note that even in our Christian relationships, disputes and unfortunate distractions are inevitable. It's going to happen. Even Paul and Barnabas experienced them. John Mark does resurface later in the narrative when Barnabas tries to persuade Paul to take Mark on another trip. We'll read about this in a few weeks. Paul's not exactly thrilled with the idea. However, I've got great news. Conflict does not have to end in failure. Relationships can be restored. Ultimately, we will see a restoration in this relationship. Paul actually mentions Mark much later on in 2 Timothy. Paul asks Mark to visit him. Paul calls Mark useful. So yes, we will experience conflict even in our Christian relationships. However, we can also experience restoration in those same relationships. Praise God for that. Verse 14. But they went on from Perga and came to Antioch in Pisidia. And on the Sabbath day, they went into the synagogue and sat down. Now, Luke briefly mentions this journey to Antioch in Pisidia, but what he doesn't tell us is just how difficult this journey must have been, we actually need to look at geography and history to see what they went through. Geography tells us that they would have gone through mountains. They would have literally been clinging to cliffs in parts of this journey. They would have had to cross terrifying rivers. History tells us that there were bandits in this area known for attacking people on these trails. These guys were making all kinds of sacrifice for the sake of the gospel. Ministry is not for the faint of heart. Advancing the gospel always comes at a great cost. This is true even throughout church history. Servants like Charles Spurgeon, Martin Luther, and William Wilberforce all suffered from health problems. George Whitefield and David Livingston suffered from violent threats. And there are still unreached people groups today in the world because they live in extreme, hard-to-access places. Do they need to know the gospel? Yes. Is it our job to take it to them? Yes. Some unreached peoples live in dangerous places where society is violently hostile to Christianity. Here in Acts 13, we see this example of grace-enabled endurance that must exist in the hearts of gospel-centered, spirit-empowered, Christ-exalting missionaries. A grace-enabled endurance. And I would argue that we all need that grace-enabled endurance in our own walk with the Lord. Verse 14 again, they went on from Perga and came to Antioch in Pisidia, and on the Sabbath day they went into the synagogue and sat down. Now don't get Antioch in Pisidia confused with Antioch in Syria, which we read about in previous weeks. This is a different Antioch. This one is actually in the region of Galatia. Maybe that sounds a little familiar. Also note, it's the Sabbath day, and our missionaries are at the local synagogue. Verse 15. After the reading from the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent a message to them saying, "Brothers, if you have any word of encouragement for the people, say it." This is great. This is an open invitation to preach. And how often is this going to come about? So typically in the Jewish service, there's an order of service, much like we have. And this portion of the service would have been more like an expositional sermon. So then they look up to Paul and say, "You want to go? Are you ready?" And I love this because we don't know why they asked. It's possible they heard about Paul's incredible training under Gamaliel, which was a great leader and rabbi. What we'll see here are some similarities with Paul's sermon, with Peter's Pentecost sermon. You'll also see some similarities with Stephen's sermon in Acts 7 that we read a few months back. Something I find fascinating here, and you'll see this, is that Paul does not waver when it comes to proclaiming the gospel. He doesn't waver. He's given the opportunity, and he delivers. But what is really interesting, no, he doesn't waver. He does, however, change his approach based on the audience he's in front of. His sermon here is primarily to a Jewish crowd, and that's different from when we see him witnessing to pagans. We'll actually see this in the coming weeks, and it's fascinating. We'll try to break this down a little bit, but Paul uses different approaches based on the people he's talking to. The gospel message doesn't change. How he goes about delivering that message does. I would argue that we will face the same challenges today when it comes to sharing the gospel in our own lives. For example, you don't try to evangelize your 70-year-old grandma who grew up going to Sunday school the same way you would try to evangelize your Muslim neighbor who has a completely different worldview. Do they both need to hear the same gospel? Yes. Are you going to take a different approach with both people? Absolutely. We need to be able to share the fixed gospel with flexible communication if we want to reach people effectively. I love the way Steve Timmis says it. He says it like this. He says, in every situation, there needs to be a point of contact with the people and a point of conflict that reveals how their own narrative conflicts with that of the gospel. Here in Acts 13, it's a Jewish setting, so what does Paul do? Paul exalts Jesus from the Old Testament. He knows his audience is very familiar with the Old Testament scriptures. So he uses their grasp of scripture to show that Jesus is the hero of the Bible. Not them. Jesus is the hero. So we're going to break Paul's Christ-exalting sermon up into three main parts, and we'll also see that it's received with somewhat of a mixed reaction. Now, before we dive into this, you'll note that I could probably read Paul's sermon here in about 3 minutes. So your first thought is, why would you ever preach longer than 3 minutes if that's all it took for Paul? Well, let me defend a longer sermon. We do know that this was not Paul's entire sermon. This was sort of a highlight reel. We also know that Paul was known for long sermons. You'll probably know this story, but in Acts 20, Paul doesn't stop preaching, and he preaches so long, he goes into the night, and a guy falls asleep mid-sermon. You know that one? Falls three stories down to his death. Paul brings him back to life. You'd think that would be a great ending to his sermon. No, he keeps preaching. Highlight reel. Paul's intro. Check this out, verse 16. So, Paul stood up and motioning with his hand said, "Men of Israel, and you who fear God, listen." Verse 17. "The God of this people, Israel, chose our fathers and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt. And with uplifted arm, he led them out. And for about 40 years, he went up with them in the wilderness. And after destroying seven nations in the land of Canaan, he gave them their land as an inheritance." Verse 20. "All this took about 450 years. And after that, he gave them judges until Samuel the prophet. Then, verse 21, they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. Verse 22, "And when he had removed him, he raised up David to be their king, of whom he testified and said, 'I have found in David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart who will do all my will.'" Does anybody else want that said about them? Verse 23, "Of this man's offspring, God has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus, as he promised." 24, "Before his coming, John had proclaimed a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. And as John was finishing his course, he said, 'What do you suppose that I am? I am not he. No, but behold, after me one is coming, the sandals of whose feet I am not worthy to untie.'" Paul opens this incredible sermon by emphasizing God's grace to Israel as he briefly summarizes the history of the Israelites. What you'll notice here, if you were to do a little word study, is that God is the subject of nearly every verb he chooses. This sermon is scripture-saturated, God-centered, and Christ-exalting. Three key ingredients to a great sermon. Paul reminds his audience here that our God is not a random acting God. He knows exactly what he's doing. Paul gives a brief sketch of Israel's history leading up to the coming of Christ. And then the intro of Paul's sermon culminates in the arrival of David's greater son, Jesus, God's promised Messiah, the world's Savior. Paul's sermon now takes a shift into proclamation. He begins to proclaim the death and resurrection of Christ. Look at verse 26. "Brothers, sons of the family of Abraham," Paul knows exactly who he's talking to, "and those among you who fear God, to us has been sent the message of this salvation. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize him nor understand the utterance of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, fulfilled them by condemning him. And though they found in him no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb." The people actually thought that Jesus was the opposite of who he really was. So they killed him. But, verse 30, God raised him from the dead. But God raised him from the dead. Resurrection is verification. The resurrection proved that Jesus' work on the cross was sufficient. Verse 31. And for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people. Paul says, look, don't just take my word for it. There are now eyewitnesses who can testify to Jesus' bodily resurrection. And then Paul goes on to cite several verses showing that in these very specific ways, prophecies about Jesus have been fulfilled. Look at verse 32. And we bring you the good news that what God promised to the fathers, this he has fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus. Also, it's written in the second psalm, you are my son. Today, I have begotten you. Verse 34. And as for the fact that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption, he has spoken in this way, I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David. Therefore, he says also in another psalm, you will not let your Holy One see corruption. For David, verse 36, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers and saw corruption. But, verse 37, he whom God raised up did not see corruption. Jesus, the Holy One, Jesus, the universal King, did not decay like King David. Paul's sermon here is a great reminder for us that we must keep the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus the main message of our ministries. Christ is the hero of the Bible, and he must remain the hero of our teaching and our preaching. So if you came here today looking for self-help, if you came here today looking for a feel-good, me-centered sermon, you're not going to find it. We will exalt the risen Savior each and every week because Jesus is the hero of the story. Paul's sermon now shifts from proclamation to application. What do Christ's death and resurrection mean for them? What does it mean for us? Verse 38. Let it be known to you, therefore. Note the transitional word, therefore. Brothers, that through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. And by him, everyone, who? Everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. Paul, in effect, says this. Here's the good news of the gospel. You can have forgiveness of sins through Christ. You can be justified. Fancy word. What does that mean? Justified, just as if I never sinned. You could take it one step further. Justified, just as if I always obeyed. How? How could we possibly be justified? Paul tells us we can be declared righteous in God's sight through Jesus. Core doctrine here. We can't earn righteousness, we must receive it. There's nothing we can do to earn it. Has anybody ever wrestled with the problem of guilt before? That nagging feeling you just can't seem to shake because you know you're not good enough. You know, the world offers a lot of potential solutions to deal with guilt, but they all fall short. We can try therapy, exercise, diets, medicines, countless other remedies. Are these bad things? No. No, they're not bad things. But I will say this, there's only one solution to our guilt problem. We must trust in Christ alone. That's it. We must trust in Christ alone. Jesus says to repentant sinners, you are forgiven. You are free from condemnation. Paul says everyone who believes is justified, just as if I never sinned through him. Will you rest the weight of your sin, your guilt, and your restless conscience on him? Will you rest in the grace of Jesus today? I'm begging you, stop seeking satisfaction, fulfillment, and purpose in the things this world has to offer. They will never satisfy you, fulfill you, or give you purpose. Maybe you're here today, or you're watching online, and you're thinking, yeah, but you don't know what I've done. And you're right. I don't. But I know a guy who knows exactly what you've done. I would say this, I want you to think again. Because even those who put Jesus to death were not beyond the reach of God's saving grace. There is nothing you can do or have already done that disqualifies you from the love of God. Do not believe that lie. Paul then adds a warning for those who would scoff at and reject the gospel. Maybe you've experienced this before in witnessing to friends, family, neighbors, just a complete discredit, neglect. Paul has some words of warning for them here. He quotes Habakkuk 1:5, verse 40. He says, beware, therefore, lest what is said in the prophets should come about. 41. Look, you scoffers, be astounded and perish. For I am doing a work in your days, a work that you will not believe, even if one tells it to you. Paul says, don't set this matter aside. This here is a matter of eternal life and eternal judgment. Paul's given the opportunity to speak, and it is no holds barred. He warns against the hardness of heart. He warns against the cynic who scoffs at truth. And it's oftentimes people assume that it's because of some lofty intellectual argument that people make fun of the message of salvation. But accepting or rejecting Christ isn't about your intelligence, it's about your heart. Last week, we read about an intelligent man, Sergius Paulus, who became a Christian. But here, many in the crowd refuse Paul's message because of nothing more than hard-heartedness. Let's take a look at the mixed reaction to Paul's sermon. Verse 42. As they went out, the people begged that these things might be told to them next week. Next Sabbath. Some people are like, will you come back? That was a great sermon. Let's hear a follow-up. Verse 43, and after the meeting of the synagogue broke up, many Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who, as they spoke with them, urged them to continue in the grace of God. So one group wanted them to come back next week. Others followed Paul and Barnabas, both physically and spiritually. They were all in. Let's see what happens next week. Verse 44, the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered. Don't overlook this. His original audience was Jewish. Now we have both Jew and Gentile together. The whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. Something incredible is happening. However, not everyone was exactly thrilled with the large crowd they were drawing. Verse 45. But when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began to contradict that what was spoken by Paul, reviling him. It's so sad here because it's the people who knew the Bible the most that became the most hostile. Isn't that awful? And when they didn't have an argument, they just decided to attack them. Look what Paul and Barnabas did, verse 46. And Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying, "It was necessary that the word of God be spoken first to you," speaking to the Jews, "since you thrust it aside and judge yourselves unworthy for eternal life. Behold, we are turning to the Gentiles." Wow. 47. "For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, 'I have made you a light to the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth.'" What did the Gentiles do? Verse 48. "When the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as were appointed to eternal life believed." This announcement actually causes the Gentiles to rejoice, to worship, to believe. And the book of Acts is filled with expressions of God's sovereign plan at work in salvation of sinners. Verse 49. "And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region. But the Jews incited the devout women of high standing and the leading men of the city, stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and drove them out of their district." 51. "But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit." Sometimes missionaries endure persecution and they're forced to move on as a result of it. On this occasion, they leave town, they shake the dust off their feet. This is a sign of God's indictment against that place. But what does our author tell us? He says they leave filled with joy. They leave filled with joy and filled with the Holy Spirit. How could this be? They were just persecuted. They were just kicked out of town. Once again, and we read about this last week, we see this connection between suffering for the sake of the gospel and Christian joy. And how could this be possible? I want to close this morning with a story I heard this week about some missionaries in Southeast Asia. This didn't happen that long ago. They were sharing the gospel with some unreached people there in a remote village. And slowly, the village started saying, maybe this is true. They were making progress with the people. Now, these were animistic people, meaning they believed in all kinds of gods and spirits, and they had all kinds of idols in their homes and trinkets they would wear around their necks and on their wrists. They were intended to ward off evil spirits in their village. But as they began studying their Bibles and hearing the gospel proclaimed, they thought, well, if this message is true, we don't need these idols in our life anymore. So people started to remove their idols from their homes. They were taking their trinkets off their neck, and they began piling them up in the middle of town, getting ready for a big bonfire. This was exciting. The missionaries were thrilled until one day they came into the village to check on the people, and they noticed that some of the idols were missing, and they saw people grabbing their trinkets and putting them back on, and they were very confused. The believers said to the people, "What are you doing? Why are you doing this?" And the people shared with them that their village leader had died, and they thought that his death was because they were believing in what the missionaries were teaching. So the believers got together and they started praying, "God, we don't understand. God, this makes no sense. We were so close. They were so close. Why now? Why did this happen? God, what do you want us to do?" So they decided that the least they could do was to express their condolences to the village leader's family. Now, it was customary in that village to keep the dead body in the house for a few days, and then they would have a burial ceremony after that. So they go up to the house, and it's surrounded with people in mourning, obviously. They walk into the house, and they find the wife of the leader. She's standing there. They go over. They express their condolences to her. Then the missionaries walk over to the body. And they begin quietly praying that God would show his love to these people, that he would show his grace, his glory, his power. and that his truth would be made known to the people in the middle of all of this pain. And while the believers were praying over this dead man's body, the dead man coughed. Coughed. Silence in the house. Everyone froze. And then the guy coughed again. People came over. The village leader, who had been dead for several days, started breathing. The people held him up. Everyone is looking at these Christians like, what just happened? What did you do? And the believers decided this was a good time to share the gospel. So they did. And a massive change came about in this village. People came to know Christ. They did indeed throw their idols into a bonfire. Now, I hear this story, and some of you are thinking, really? Like, was he really dead? Or was he just kind of dead? Obviously, I wasn't there. But I do know that in villages like this, they know how to recognize death. But come on. Think about this. Even if the guy wasn't all the way dead, God sure chose an opportune moment for that guy to cough. Right? There's a lot of things I don't know, but here's something I do know. We have the good news of a king who's conquered death. A king who has the power to say to the dead, come back to life. A king who can say to the spiritually dead, rise. Who can give life when there seems to be no way. So it just makes sense for us Christians, for us believers, that we would sacrifice our lives, that we would sacrifice our families, and we would sacrifice the church on mission from where we live to go to the ends of the earth to make the good news of Jesus known. Perhaps you're familiar with the Bible but have never trusted in Jesus. Let me just say this. You need to know that salvation does not depend on how many Bible verses you memorized as a kid. You must come to faith in the living Savior, the King of Kings who's conquered death and who can still raise people from the dead. Christians in the room, are you ready to explain the good news to those around you? To your friends, to your family, to those at school? Are you ready for opposition? We've already read about this. It's inevitable. It's going to happen. But along with persevering in spite of opposition comes a deep joy that can only come from obedience to Jesus. Maybe you're here this morning and you just feel so far away from God. God hasn't gone anywhere. Please don't harden your heart. Let him do an incredible work in your life. I promise you will experience a joy and a peace and a satisfaction and a sense of purpose like never before. Does it mean the road will be easy for the life of a believer? No. But is it worth it? Yes. Let's pray. God, we trust you. We believe in you. We know you still perform incredible miracles today. Even though we might not ever see someone who's physically dead be brought back to life, God, we do see all the time you bringing spiritually dead people back to life. So I lift up those here this morning or watching online who would say, you know what, I'm spiritually dead inside. I've tried everything this world has to offer, and it's still not enough. So Holy Spirit, will you just work? Will you move? Will you soften hearts? God, I pray that as a result of your word going forth today, lives would be changed. God, I lift up the believers in this room who maybe don't have a close walk with you. God, will you rekindle that relationship? We believe you're in the restoration business, so will you start by restoring your relationship with them? God, we thank you for Paul, Barnabas, John, Mark, and these great missionaries that we read about who were willing to go, who were willing to sacrifice, who were willing to do whatever you asked of them. So God, may we follow in this example as believers, as a church, may we just be willing to go. God, I believe you've put all of us here for a purpose. We live where we live for a purpose. We work where we work for a purpose. I don't believe there's such thing as a professional Christian. You've called us to go and to spread the good news. And if that means with our family, so be it. If that means at work, okay. So God, will you give us the boldness to do so? And may we too, as we go, may we be filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 So will you now go? Will you go in the power of the Holy Spirit, telling the nations how to find forgiveness through Christ, even though it might cost you?
Can you tell me nothing I have ever done could separate my heart from the God who stays?
This is the story of a runaway. The best of me away. I had my chance. It's too late now. Too far gone.